G'day and welcome back to the workshop. Here's my current fly cutter and it's a bit on the small side. It's time to make a bigger one. I'll be using this 75mm round bar, which is made of 1045 steel. The main reason I'm making the video is because no one else has ever made a video on YouTube about fly cutters. I searched every machining channel I could find and couldn't find any. If I'm wrong about that, please hit the like button to let me know. And if I got it right, then that's great. Maybe we can chat about it in the comments. The material is pretty round, but it doesn't have to be perfect. I'm going to skim the outside anyway, but it makes sense to get it as true as I can. I'm using a WNMG cutter here, and this insert is for steel, and it has a bit of an edge radius. And now I'm using an aluminium insert, which has a bit more rake and a sharper edge. I'm not sure which I prefer yet, but I thought I'd show the finish I'm getting with both of them. I'm turning this shank down to 25mm, which will let it go straight into a collet. I should also mention now that I'm copying this design, more or less, from Matty at Matty's workshop. I rang him up and he gave me the dimensions, so thank you mate. After experimenting with speeds and feeds a bit, it's going okay. This is 485rpm, a 25 thou depth of cut and a 6 thou feed. Sorry about the imperial, but I'm using an imperial lathe. I got tired of chips hitting me, so I lodged my chip brush up there and that blocks most of them. I saw Keith Fenner do that once a few years ago, and the idea stuck with me. Obviously now I'm just carving off a lot of material. I'm getting some blue 6s and 9s shaped chips, which is nice. Now I've turned the part around and chucked it in the 3 jaw, and I'm doing a quick facing. The finish on this bit doesn't matter at all, because it'll be milled away at an angle in a few minutes. Now I'm using a CCMT cutter. And I find it quite difficult to get a perfect finish straight off the lathe, so I spend a little time with a file and Scotch-Brite. I don't think there's anything wrong with that, as long as it's not a critical surface. It's not a bad finish at the end and I can't feel any machining marks. This thumb wheel I made a while back is still working well. I made a video about that and I'll leave a link in the corner. I do need to get power feed on this machine. All this cranking makes me cranky. I'm just installing the 12-sided collet block into the vise. It's straight up and down at first, so that I can edge find the front and back. And then I use my DRO to halve that, and that gives me a centre line. Then I tilt the work over, and I get it close to 10 degrees, in preparation for giving it a bit of a haircut. I'm using a 5/8 or a 16mm high-speed steel roughing bit for this. I don't strictly need to go all the way down to the corner, but I do want to get close. Now I've got to work out my end mill speed. 35 meters a minute is the surface speed for mild steel and with a 16mm cutter. This is my method and it gives me a close approximation of the right speed. I've set up my VFD so that it knows the gearing for my favorite belt position, and that allows the VFD to work out the final RPM, so I can just dial in the RPM directly. I'm taking it easy here because there's a lot of stick out from the vise, and if I take heavy interrupted cuts, my quill splines get quite noisy, This is a problem that keeps cropping up, and so it's something I want to fix soon. One of the things I've read in the comments section is that people really appreciate when mistakes are shown in videos. So what I did was I made that mistake on purpose, just so that I can include it in the video. It was easy to plan it out, I just made sure I didn't have the part quite tight enough in the vise. So if you want to recreate that mistake, that's what you need to do. And later on, if you're well behaved, I'll show you another mistake. So after resetting the angle to 10 degrees and going gronky gronky on the vise, I'll go softly softly on the feed. I recently found a skinny nozzle that fits on my shop vac, and it is a game changer. I'd been using the standard large round one and getting problems with clogged hoses and so on. And now I've got more reach, cleaning up chips is easier, and I get fewer blockages, so do yourself a favour and try it. Can't believe I went so long with just the round one. Here is fly cutter inception. We're using a fly cutter to build a fly cutter. Maybe one day the bigger one will be used to build an even bigger one. There's nothing at all wrong with this small fly cutter, it does a great job, it's just small. I'd like to be able to cut a larger area in one pass. This fly cutter was given to me by a good friend called Jeff. He had it for his mini mill, then I had it for my mini mill, and when I upgraded my mill to a bigger one, I just kept on using it. But there are plenty of times when I do need a larger cut. Okay, that slot drill measures just under 12 mil with the calipers. It's actually marked as a 1532. I already have the y-axis zeroed on the middle of the workpiece, so I plug in the cutter diameter into the DRO, and I use the half function to work out a new zero point. This will offset the trench I'm about to make so that the edge of the trench sits on the midline of the workpiece. This is a bit like when you're using a lathe and you're trying to get your tool on centre height. Not many people realise, but quite a bit of machining information was documented back in the 60s by the Beatles. They had a practice of encoding specific machining methods into some of their songs. For example, in 1969, John captured this process perfectly with this short passage. "Here come old flat top, he come grooving up slowly." I kind of need three hands for this, one to crank the feed handle, one to blow away chips, and one to squirt coolant. Or maybe I just need a power feed and a mist cooler. I do have the bits and pieces around the place, all ready for those projects, I just need to do it, so watch this space. I also have to dial in, on the fine quill feed, a 100 thou depth of cut. And I do have a digital quill scale which I can install, and I also have a glass scale which I can install on the knee. So if those were both done, I could dial in my cuts in metric. But both of them need installing, and I haven't quite done it yet. There are a few jobs on the list like that, which would make this mill really properly commissioned and usable, plus addressing that quill spine issue that I mentioned earlier. I'm being really careful here because this is the same kind of cut that gave me issues earlier. I didn't really do that on purpose, it was just a poor choice on my part. I didn't want to make the same mistake again, so I'm taking lighter cuts. And then I had a brainwave. I realised I could hold the collet block horizontally and angle the vise, and tram in that freshly milled fly cutter head against the y-axis, and attack the problem from the other direction. I do think this is the better work-holding solution. You can see I had a few goes at milling that shoulder there. I think it moved again once, maybe, and I lost a bit more confidence in the setup. The new setup feels a lot more rigid, and I had a lot more success with it. This is a good time to admit a small design change. This shoulder is 1 millimetre deeper than it ought to have been, because when the part walked sideways in the vise earlier, it left some marks below the planned cut line. It doesn't change the functionality at all, it works fine, and I'm not too worried. If it were an important precision part or a job for someone else, I'd start again with the part, obviously. But for this, it's absolutely fine, it's only clearance for the screw heads. I finish off this shoulder rebate with a climb cut pass, and that went quite well. I often get a bit of squeal or chatter when I'm doing an edge cut with a two flute end mill or a slot drill. They're not really designed for much side milling. Four flute end mills have got a fatter core and they're much more rigid and would be the right tool for the job, but this worked fine. I'm only taking off a couple of thou. And now for a bit of blissful Zen hand filing. I really love watching people like Tom Lipton do some hand filing. I've learned a lot about patience and taking my time over details from people like Tom. It's almost a meditation, very calming. I think it's well worth the time spent. You're only seeing a minute or so here, but it took me 10 or 15 minutes to finish this part, and it's a nice pause in machining. When you're hand filing, there's no noise, no chips, no chance of your machines turning you into human mincemeat. You don't have to wear a face shield or have your ears assaulted by noise, it's just nice. You can focus on whatever you want to focus on, and this process is one of the highlights for me. And it makes the end result so much better. Everything feels good, looks good, all the burrs are gone and the chamfers or radiuses are what they should be. It makes for a much more professional job. Anyway, I'll stop there, I think maybe I'm overselling it. If you don't like this hand filing stuff, skip ahead to the next chapter. After putting some finishing touches on, I test out the fit, and it's very tight. I wanted it to be a good fit. It turns out that this insert tool is actually slightly tapered, it's a bit fatter towards the business end. I was planning on making the fit good enough that I could completely skip the grub screws. I don't think that was too optimistic, but I think I'll put them in there anyway just for safety's sake. So it's back to the mill for some spot drilling to help my 5mm drill stay on centre. I'm using some sulphur-based cutting oil to help make this go more smoothly. I'm tap drilling. And then chamfering to give the tap an easy start. And then I just lightly grip the tap in the collet, which really is a bit of an abuse of the collet. I would really like to make a tap follower for this kind of job. And I let the mill drive a couple of threads into the part, and I finish those off by hand. These are not machine taps, so it's best to hand drive them really. Clean off the goop. Take off any exit wounds using a needle file, and then we're ready to assemble. I'm using a left-hand tool here, which takes a DCMT insert. I've actually got a DCGT insert on it though, which is a high-rake, sharp-edged thing. I'm feeding by hand, of course, and I'm probably using too fast of a feed rate here for fly cutting, and taking too deep of a cut to get any good kind of finish. But I'm trying to get under this scale and rust in one go and not kill the insert. So I do that roughing pass, which still comes out surprisingly nice and flat. And then I come back and do a slower feed with a shallower depth of cut. And I'm really pleased with how this came out. Beautiful finish, and I couldn't be happier. This tool is a really useful addition to the machine. And now I can make a 150mm diameter pass in one go. And that's something I've never been able to do. And I'm happy that this is a new tool made from scratch, and with it, I can produce a better finish than I can with any other tool in the workshop. That's a win, if you ask me. Thanks for watching, and if you found this useful and interesting, please hit the subscribe button. And if you have just way too much money to deal with each month, please chuck a gold coin in the hat, Patreon, and I promise I'll use it to make better videos and put them out more frequently. Thanks again. Catch you next time.